Rabbi Label Lamb. And it's so funny because they're both going to be in the building this week together. So it was a big zechut for us to have Rabbi Mizrachi. And of course, we're very excited. And I can tell you that I once heard Rabbi Mizrachi's shiur about a year ago. I was doing some fundraising for the Chinese auction. And you should know that Rabbi Mizrachi is the only rabbi that, when I asked him to really speak about the yeshiva, he had no clue what yeshiva I'm talking about even. But he went out and he spoke about for over 10 minutes about the importance of what the yeshiva is all about. And it's big zechut, and you guys, after the shiur, I'll give you some, any questions you ask, that you have, you may ask the Rebbe. And without further ado, we'll ask Rabbi Mizrachi, please, b'chavod.
Good afternoon, or evening, I should say. I have to admit that I'm very, very happy that I had the zchut to come to speak to such nice bachurim like you, matmidim in the Torah, so polite, with great manners. We went and checked one class at the time, and Baruch Hashem, everyone is very, very serious in the learning. And looking at you, it shows that the Jewish nation has a future, Baruch Hashem. And we would like to speak maybe now for half an hour. And I know the Rav said that the question could be in the end, but I don't mind if you have questions in the middle. All you have to do is raise your hand and ask me any question you want, even if it's off the topic. Any question you have, general questions, personal questions, halacha questions, hashkafa questions, musar questions, parsha, whatever you have, you can ask me, because I prefer to answer your questions than just give you a speech here. Guys in your age have a lot of threats out there today. Coming to yeshiva all day, Baruch Hashem, being with the books, with the Torah of Hashem, with great rabbanim that are teaching you from morning to night. So as long as you're here, you are protected, Baruch Hashem. The question is, what happened when you leave the building? In this generation, the nisyonot, the tests that we have in this generation, perhaps are the greatest in history. What I mean is, in the old days, there was no technology, no internet, no Facebook, no emails, no televisions, no telephone, no cell phone. Even though all these things that I mentioned, we use for our own benefits. We use it for business, we use it for parnasa, we use it even to learn Torah. But the danger in these things that I mentioned is tremendous. We found many times that guys your age that were learning and they will have great marks, mamash like holy kids. And God forbid, when they tried out of curiosity with one of the cousins, one of the neighbors, somebody that they were embarrassed to tell him no, and offered them to visit in these places that a Jew that is Yerei Shamayim is not supposed to go there, completely not allowed. And from that moment on, their life was never the same. To build a building may take years. You put one brick after the other, another floor, and another floor, until you said the wiring, the plumbing, to make the floor, make the ceiling, electric, permits. To knock it down takes exactly a minute. It could take you 3-4 years to build a building. To make yourself a Talmid Chacham may take 20, 30, 40 years. Depend how sharp is your brain, but it's mainly depend on how serious you are, if you matmid or not. What's more important, what do you think? To be naturally smart from birth, or to be a serious learning with devotion, put all your heart into the learning, even if you're not the smartest person in the world? What do you think in the long run, what do you think will pay off? Being a sharp guy that everything he understands quickly, but is not so serious in the learning, or having difficulty understanding, but never give up. Learning, always come on time, always stay to the end, never tell story, never pretend that he doesn't feel good. because he wants to rest, or all kinds of excuses, or he cares about going to this wedding and to that party and to that Sheva Brachos, and then he's tired the next day all day, he cannot learn. That shows how serious a person is in Avodat Hashem, in the learning of Hashem. What do you think is more important? Of course, it's great to have both. If you're very smart, and plus you're very serious, that's the ideal. But if you had to choose one of the two, which one you would have to choose first? Yes?
Second.
Which one is the second one? Being serious or being sharp from birth? In your learning? Being serious. Who disagree with him? Anyone disagree? What do you think is more important? What do you think?
Being serious.
Being sharp. Being sharp? Okay, now you have to explain to me why. Why do you think it's more important to be sharp in learning than to be serious? I need to know where you're coming from. What do you think? Why do you think it's more important? Or you meant both of them together, it's important.
I think both, because you need both of them to learn. You need seriousness to learn, and you need sharpness, because you need sharpness and seriousness at the same time to learn, like Gemara. You need a sharp mind to think of the cases, and you need seriousness to learn more, not to like just like to look at
mind. Okay, so let me ask you a question. Yeah, no, you didn't know. So I'm saying to you like this, look, if a person is not the smartest in the world, do you think he has the chance to become Gdol Ador?
Yes.
How is it going to be? If it's very hard for him to understand. So let me tell you a story. When I was younger, when I was learning, like you, in yeshiva, we had a guy in the yeshiva that his mind was almost completely black. It's mamash, Hashem Yerachem, like a curse. Everything he learns, he cannot understand anything. And what happened is, every time new bachurim comes to yeshiva, they learn with him 2-3 weeks, right away they become better than him, and he's already years in yeshiva. They become better than him, then they quietly come to the Rebbe, get me a better chevruta, I feel I'm wasting my time. Get me a better chevruta, get me a better chevruta. And like this, one after the other is passing from, you know, being his chevruta, and he's staying in the same level for more than 3 years. But one thing he had, what did he had? He was the first one who sit in the seder next to the Gemara with the Gemara open. He was the last one to leave. He never missed a day. He never gave up. He was writing in his notebook. And Rosh Yeshiva used to say, for me, I don't care what the clock say on the wall. Don't tell me the clock is fast, the clock is behind. I don't care. When that guy is already opening his Gemara, that means the Seder started. Why? He knew he will never be late a minute. It was very serious. And what do you think happened in the end? All of a sudden, like out of nowhere, he became the best learner in yeshiva. Everything opened in one shot. Once it's opened, it's open. You have to know one thing. Learning Torah is different than learning math or history or science or anything else you learn. Everything is important. The more educated you are, it's very good. But learning Torah is different. Learning math, if you learn 5 hours, you know based on 5 hours of learning. If you learn 10 hours, you know double. If you learn 15 hours, you know triple. The more you learn based on the hours, the more you know. Learning Torah, if you learn the first 5 hours, you know X amount. Then if you learn 10 hours, you know much more than double. And if you learn now 20 hours, you know 10 times more. It doesn't grow from 1 to 2, from 2 to 4, no. It's all a gift from Hashem. You have to know that. Hashem is giving us gift to understand His Torah. Without Hashem's help, nobody can understand the deepness of His Torah. You can only understand the meaning of the word, but that's it. The Gemara that you learn now, or the Mishnah that you learn, is much, much, much more deeper than what you think. You're still young, and you cannot see the deepness of it. Maybe in another 5 or 10 years from now, you will begin to see things that you don't even dream exist in the same pages you're learning right now. As a matter of fact, the only thing that the more you learn it, the more you find out more and more secrets inside is the Gemara. You learn it once, you understand the story. You learn it again, you see things you didn't see before. After 10, 20 times you learn the same page, you do Chazara, you repeat. Every time you see something and you know how to connect it to different Gemara and the picture become more and more clear. Now you have to know one thing. How much you're going to understand, it depends how you behave with Hashem. Let me give you a list of requirements, what you have to be successful in your learning in life. First, how much effort you put in the learning. First thing Hashem check each one of you, how serious you are in the class. How much you try to understand. How many times you repeat it. When you come home, you do the homework. Are you serious? If you don't understand, you call, you check. You meet with a friend to explain to you. You ask the Rebbe to go over it for you. If Hashem sees that you love the Torah and this is all your life, every once in a while, he give you a gift and open another channel in your brain. That things that you could not do before, now you see. It's all a gift. It's against logic. It's against nature. You don't have it when you learn history. You can be very serious in history. Whatever you learn, you know. That's it. Same thing math, same thing anything. Torah is different. It's all matana from HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Sometimes you find Baalei Tshuva, people who did not grow up from, they didn't know anything about religion, they give up the work, they come to yeshiva, what they do in 1 or 2 years, somebody else doesn't do in 10 years. They have big siyata dishmaya. Why? Hashem appreciate that they gave up money, they gave up a job, they gave up all kinds of things with their friends, they left everything, because they want age 22, 25, 30 to come and start learn Torah like kids in pre-1A and first grade. That's what happened to Rabbi Akiva. Would you ever imagine that the greatest Jew in history is a person that started to learn Aleph Bet age 40? Age 40, older than some of your Rebbeim. He started to learn Aleph Bet when every kid in his generation knew a million times more than what the kids know today, should know, in his generation. This was generation that the 6 years old knew the whole Mishnah by heart. They knew hundreds of pages by heart. Many, many big chachamim were in that time. You know why? They didn't have all the technology, things that destroy the mind. They didn't have all kinds of movies and things that occupy the brain. Everything they had in life was Torah. There was no electric. There was really nothing to do. There's no bicycle, no driving around, no going to fancy wedding, not to the pizza store or to Coca-Cola. None of these things existed. Life, besides the Torah, was very boring. It was very hard work. People your age, besides learning 10 hours a day or sometimes 12, 14 hours a day, they had to work very hard physical work. They had to go bring water from the well. Maybe 10 times a day, they have to bring for the neighbor, for the grandfather, the water is very heavy. They have to milk the cows, they have to work with the sheep, they have to cut the trees, they have to pick up all the fruits from the floor, they have to put basket, they have to go help the father plowing the ground and put seeds and bringing water. So much hard work. As a matter of fact, places in the world like South America, Guatemala, El Salvador, Mexico, kids your age, they start to learn at 8 o'clock in the morning. Sometimes I hear kids complain that davening started at 7. Wow, it's hard for me to get up. These kids at 5 o'clock in the morning already going to the field to work with their father in a very hot, humid weather for 3 hours. They finish working. They come to school, they learn until 4 or 5 in the afternoon. What do you think they do? They go to the Facebook or to the computer? No, they don't have it over there. They're a very primitive country. They go back to work until late at night. And then they go back to learn, and they go back to work, and go back to learn. This is the life they have, and they don't get a chance to complain. Baruch Hashem, Hashem has mercy on us. Your parents work very hard for you to be here. They pay for you to be here. They pray for you to be here. But if you're not going to do the job, nobody will do the job for you. What do we learn in Pirkei Avos? Im en ani li, mi li. If I won't take care of my neshama, nobody will do the job for me. You understand? If I do it, nobody will do the job for me. So what are the requirements? Rule number one, full efforts. Being serious, showing Hashem how much you love the Torah and respect it. Rule number two, your midot. You're working on your character to correct your personality, to correct the negative things about you, or you don't care about it. Midot is very important to be successful in Torah. Because the whole purpose that Hashem gave us the Torah, to become better people. Not stingy, not angry, not lying, not cheating, being tzanua, modest, watching our eyes. This is all a matter of midot. There is no way to become a tzaddik without learning very serious Torah. But you have to know that you cannot become a big talmid chacham, holy person, if you're not working on your midot. If you only know Torah and you do not correct who you are, you're still angry, you still speak Lashon Hara, you still fight with everyone in the games, you still get very upset when you lose a basketball game, you have big ego, it's all about pride, people offend you, all these things. If you do not work about getting rid of it in your personal life, then it's affecting your Torah. You know, the Gemara said that someone who knows a lot of Torah but did not improve his personality, did not improve his midot, did not improve his respect to his parents, respect to his Rebbe, respect to his friends, honesty, how he conducts with his friends, how, you know, even playing something with your monopoly with your friends. This is where Hashem checks you. If you're an honest person, or you're lying, or you're cheating, or you're stealing, all these little things, you may think, it's only a game, it's no big deal, and life, I'll never do it. No, it's affecting who you are. So you have to work on your personality, on your midot 100%. The third thing, you have to beg Hashem and to cry to Him every day when you daven. Don't be embarrassed from friends that may think you're too strict or you're too religious. Don't be impressed by what they say. Only care what Hashem think about you. And you have to beg to Hashem to make you, to open up your eyes in His Torah. Va'er enenu betoratecha. Light my eye in your Torah. Help me to remember. Help me to understand. Help me to become a better person. I want to tell you a story. Right here, walking into this building, you have the pictures of the holiest rabbis who lived in this generation and in the previous generation. Among them, I saw Rav Ben Zion Abba Shaul, which was a very, very big chacham and a big tzaddik. And also Rav Yehuda Tzadka. They both came from the same yeshiva in Yerushalayim, Porat Yosef. Actually, all the Sfaradish chachamim almost came from this yeshiva. The biggest in the world came from that yeshiva. Obviously, this yeshiva was very serious, and everybody there was learning in a top ability. But I want to tell you something. When Rav Yehuda Tzadka passed away, they came to his chevruta that was learning with him every day for 30 years. 30 years. Who knows you better? Your chevruta that you learn almost all day with him for 30 years, or your wife? Your wife, you see at night, you come home from learning, or if you work, whatever, you come 8 o'clock after davening, you see her an hour or two at night, people go to sleep, and that's the end of it. A little bit on Shabbos, that's it. But someone you learn all day, from morning to night, face to face, you're supposed to know him the most in the world, no? So they come to his chevruta and they say, Rabbi, we want you to say a eulogy for the funeral of Rav Yehuda Tzadka. Nobody knows him better than you. Guess what the rabbi answered? He says, as a matter of fact, I have news for you. I don't know anything about him, nothing whatsoever. I said, Rabbi, 30 years you learned with him from morning to night. What do you mean you don't know anything about him? Now listen good, and I hope you never forget this story for the rest of your life. He said to them, from the day we started to learn when we were young until we became old, we learned for 30 years, not even one time we spoke about something besides the learning. Not one time we had a personal conversation. I don't know about his children, wife, personal story from his life, nothing. We never spoke about it. He never asked me about my life. I never asked him about his life. We opened the Gemara. From that moment, we never say one word that it's not Torah. Did you ever hear such a thing? This was only 20 years ago. When your parents were teenagers. This is it. Only 20 years ago. You understand what we're talking about? There's no reason that you won't be the same. When the Rebbe gives you an assignment, you learn together. He goes sometimes out of the room, he comes back. Don't ever say another words besides learning. Like this, Hashem see, oh, this is my jewels, these children. For it's worth it for me to give them a gift. A father that loves his son because he helps and he's devoted and he's a good boy, he helps a lot in the house. The more he does for the house, the more the father wants to give him. Here, take a gift, I buy you this. Remember what you asked me to buy you, now I'm going to buy it to you. You are, you deserve it. I don't do you a favor. You earn it. You help in the house, you're a good boy, you behave. Why not? Let me buy you this gift. The father is honored to buy it to his son, but sometimes he's forced to buy it, but he's not happy. He doesn't have a choice, but he eats his heart that he has to buy his son something that cost him a lot of money, knowing he doesn't deserve it. There's a big difference. When you earn it, it comes with blessing. When you force it, there's no blessing in it. You should know what I told you. If you remember the few things, the few points that I made, it will change your entire life for good. Everything. Now, one more thing. I know some of you come from families. Baruch Hashem, all of you come from religious families. But when I say families, I mean cousins, uncles. Maybe not all of them knows the Torah and behave according to the Torah. You probably have cousins that are not like you. Maybe they go to public school. Maybe they watch things that a Jew is not allowed even to see 1 second in his life. Maybe they talk not a clean language. Maybe you go and sit with them in weddings and you spend Shabbat sometimes, the whole family, and they talk the way a yeshiva bachur should never talk. This is your test in life, that you can earn a lot in the 1 or 2 hours that you are with your cousins and some people that may come to visit in a party of the family. This is an opportunity for you to do Kiddush Hashem. There are two kinds of kids. There are kids that in yeshiva, they behave like rabbis. They put their hat, they dress properly, they daven, they make faces. Beautiful. Mamash tzadikim. But then they go with the family and their cousin, all of a sudden they have goyim. Why? They embarrassed in front of all the cousins to become frum, to put their hat and to bench and to do birkat hamazon. Why? Maybe my cousin make fun. They tell me I'm too whatever. The opposite. A Jew should bring the ones that is below him to his level, not go to his level. You have to understand, this is an opportunity to do Kiddush Hashem. Do you understand that Kiddush Hashem is the most important things in the Torah? Chilul Hashem is the worst avera that a Jew can do. It's very difficult to correct Chilul Hashem. If somebody heard you speaking not properly, saying bad words that you're not supposed to, in case you didn't know, you can learn Torah 70 years. The Chachamim, Chazal say, you can learn Torah 70 years. You know, the more you learn Torah, thank you, the more holy you become. Do you understand what I'm saying here or no? If you learn 1 year, you have X amount of holiness. If you learn 70 years, it's a lot more. When Rabbi Akiva went to learn Torah for 24 years, he didn't go for 24 years straight. He went, the plan was that he goes for 12 years. When he came back home, he heard his wife saying to the neighbor, if I had a way to tell my husband, remember, there was no telephone, no emails. She couldn't email him to stay in yeshiva. So he came home, he was about to enter. He heard the neighbor saying to his wife, your husband forgot about you. And she answered to the neighbor, if I had a way to tell him to stay for 12 more years, I would have done it with no hesitation. I'd tell him to stay there. He turned around and went for another 12 years. Everybody asked this question. I don't understand. 12 years you did not see your wife, she's alone, no children, she's alone in a house. After 12 years you already arrive, and remember, there was no airplanes, no trains, no cars, maybe he had a donkey, and he came with his donkey after who knows how long it took him. Finally he arrived home, he sees his wife. He didn't go in to say hello to his wife. What was the problem that he stay overnight? That he stay overnight and the next day go back to yeshiva for 12 more years? The answer is, pay attention, the answer is 12 years with one day break and 12 more years, it's not equal to 24 years straight. You understand what I'm saying here or no? If he would take a day off, in this day would already lower his holiness. Now he went right back into yeshiva, it's a much greater level. You should know one thing. If a person learned Torah 70 years and then say one curse out of his mouth in a time of anger, a second later he regrets that he said this word. Hey, I'm a Jew, I'm not supposed to talk like this. The one curse that he said out of his mouth make him lose the holiness of learning Torah 70 years straight. Did you know that? You don't lose the mitzvah of learning Torah. Every mitzvah you do is yours forever. Nobody can take it away from you. But the holiness that the Torah make in your neshama, you lose right away. This is just to show you what a Chilul Hashem is. Now I will give you some time for questions. If you have questions about what I say or about different things, now you can ask me. Any questions here? ברוך אתה אדוני אלוהים מלך העולם שהכל נהיה בדברו. That's it? You know the answers to all the questions? Yeah, you have questions? No? Yeah, right here.
If you have like a non-religious family,
First of all, it's very good news. If you have relatives that wants to become religious, so you bring them and you mekarev them. The problem is that not every religious Jew know how to deal with not religious people. If it's family that is interested to become religious, you send them to me. You tell them, I'll talk to them, I'll give them the lectures, the CDs, the DVDs, we answer the question, and slowly, slowly, we make them Shomer Shabbos, we invite them maybe to a seminar, but we will know what advice to give them in every day of their life. Not everyone, especially a kid that learns in yeshiva all days in yeshiva, is busy with his learning, with his homework. He doesn't have that much time to start becoming a mekarev. Everyone has his job in life. Right now you have to focus on your learning and to grow in Torah and Yirat Shamayim. Everything, the way you dress on the street. Remember, we have to be ultra, ultra religious, not only in yeshiva. Every second of our life, whether we home, whether we sleep, whether we sit in a bathroom, whether we go to a wedding, we always have to know we are an example. We are the representative of the creator of the world. The way we behave, that's how people understand religion. If you behave nice, every one of your friends and cousins will say, wow, look at this. Look how the religious Jews behave. It's great to be religious. If chas v'shalom, you do chilul Hashem, you fight, you scream, you behave not properly, you dress not properly, they say, there's nothing better than us. If that's the religion, we better not be religious. And when you come to Shamayim, Hashem is holding you responsible. You say, you are with your cousin the entire weekend. If you behave like your Rebbe taught you in yeshiva, when you're there, your cousin will become a tzaddik and you save his neshama for eternity. Since you did not do it, look what happened to him. And they didn't show you his end and you say, wow, what a responsibility I have. I want to tell you something. When you grow up and you go to Mesifta, 10th grade, 11th, 12th grade, and then later, one day you get married and you maybe be Avrechim Bezrat Hashem, one thing you have to know. You affecting the world even when you're not thinking about it. For instance, if you sleep in a dorm one day and you have roommates in your room and you have to get up for davening, let's say it starts 7 o'clock, and you only wake up 7:05, by the time you do netila and brush your teeth and get dressed, you come already, they're already in psuke de zimra. 5 minutes, 2 minutes from now, they say barchu. That's not a way to daven. You have to do korban, you have to do birkot ha-shachar, korbanot, or do psuke de zimra. You have to come before the time, not 20 minutes later. Now, what happens if your friend is serious and he goes to the davening on time? After 5 or 10 times that he sees that you're not serious, he becomes like you. Because the way of the Yetzer Hara always to give you excuses to do the wrong thing and to make you feel good about it. Because if you feel bad about it, you don't want to repeat it. Nobody wants to feel bad. But the Yetzer Hara will come and tell you, ah, no big deal. Look, your roommate is getting up at 7:20 and nothing happened. Still daven. I still put a feeling. Everything is fine. What, something happened? So slowly, slowly he becomes like you. And then another person, and the one who taught everyone how not to behave, is really guilty of everyone else. And it could be the other way around. Maybe they're not getting up on time. You get them up. You show them an example. You encourage them. Then they become good like you. You're saving their neshama. And this is how it is. Now you have... Yeah.
There's a person who was 70 years, he learned Torah and he made a curse.
He
told Hashem that, I'm sorry, does he get all his Kedusha back?
No. Once you lose the Kedusha, it's like having water in a bucket. You made a hole, the water spilled, it's finished. But remember, you don't lose the mitzvot. Every letter of Torah that you learn is a mitzvah. I'll give you an example. I just went into one of the classrooms, and the kids were saying the Mishnah in Masechet Brachot, Me'matai Korim et Kriyat Shema, and everyone said the entire Mishnah by heart. Every letter of this Mishnah, right? You say Me'matai, 5 letters. It's like putting tefillin 5 times. Did you know that? You say Me'matai Korim et Kriyat Shema, 12 letters is like putting tefillin 12 times. People don't know it, the value of the Torah. Every day that you sit in this room, you make in average hundreds of thousands of mitzvot. Just that you know. A kid that goes to public school, even if he keeps Shabbos and he does some mitzvot, but for whatever reason his parents made a big mistake and send him to public school, he will never do mitzvot even 1% of what each one of you does in his life. Because he doesn't have 10 or 9 hours learning Torah. Every hour, the Chafetz Chaim calculated how much a Jew is earning by learning Torah per hour. So the Chafetz Chaim calculated that an average person can say 200 words a minute. And an average word in Lashon HaKodesh, you have 5 letters, which makes it 1,000 letters a minute. Of course, it can be more or less, but average, which means 60,000 mitzvot per hour. Multiply by 10 hours a day, 600,000 mitzvot per day. Multiply by 6 days of learning, 3.6 million mitzvot in 1 week. Multiply by four weeks, almost 15 million mitzvot in 1 month just from being in yeshiva. Now, another Jew that does not go to yeshiva, he keeps Shabbos, it's a nice mitzvah. Even he puts tefillin, let's say, he goes to daven with his father, he puts tefillin, then his father takes him, lo aleinu, to the public school. He eats kosher. He makes bracha quietly in front of all the goyim there because he's embarrassed. How many mitzvot he does a day? 30? 20? That's it. He cannot come nowhere near one of you. What you do in a day doesn't do in a year. Do you understand the value of the Torah? That's why you got to be extremely, extremely serious not to miss 1 minute of Torah. 1 minute of Torah. You know, one Jew, lo aleinu, was very sick. He was fighting for his life. So they decided in yeshiva that everyone will donate some mitzvot for his refuah shlema, for his health. So they came to one kid, they say, what are you going to do? He said, I'm going to read the entire Tehillim for his refuah shlema. They came to the other one, he said, I'm going to learn 10 prakim of Mishnayos for his refuah. What do you do? 10 pages of Gemara. What do you do? I'm going to do Tomche Shabbos volunteering for the whole year for him to be there. Then they came to the Rosh Yeshiva and they said, Rabbi, What are you giving for this boy to become healthy? So the rabbi say, I'm donating 1 minute of my Torah. So the guy who was making the list, he thought it's a joke. So rabbi, I'm serious. There's a boy, he's very sick. Everyone, he does the whole Tehillim, 10 prakim, 10 pages. What are you doing? He said, I'm giving 1 minute of my Torah. So he said, Rabbi, only 1 minute you give for a Jew that maybe tomorrow will not be alive? So he said to him, do you know how much I do in 1 minute? Do you know how much I do? I'm willing to give it for him. Do you know how expensive this minute? Do you know how much I'm giving up? He was 100% serious. You heard of Rav Moshe Feinstein?
Yes.
Baruch Hashem. Rav Moshe Feinstein one time made a siyum on Mishnayos. That, if you knew Rav Moshe Feinstein, that really looked like a joke. He finished the Shas more than 100 times. The entire Gemara. He knew every page by heart. Every Mefaresh, every Rashi, Tosfot, Marsha, whatever you want, he knew everything. Halacha, Shulchan Aruch. Now he does a siyum of Mishnayos. What? Siyum of Mishnayos? When he was your age, he used to finish every 2-3 days the entire Mishnah. So what's special about the Siyum of Mishnayos that he's making L'chaim? He brings wine and cakes, and in a shul they make a kiddush. So they told him, Rabbi, why are you making a Siyum on Mishnayos? He said, I feel that I got this Mishnayos as a bonus. It's like a gift. It wasn't supposed to be. Why, Rabbi, why? He said, this Mishnayos I learned every day while I was folding my tefillin. Every day I fold my tefillin for 2 minutes, right? I fold it, I put it back in a case. So I decided that instead of looking around and say, hi, how are you? What's the weather? How's the traffic? Instead of speaking about nonsense, I'm gonna fold the tefillin while learning 1 or 2 Mishnayos every day while I'm folding my tefillin. And now I finished the entire Shas Mishnayos, Shisha Sidre Mishnah, everything on the 2-3 minutes every day that I was folding my tefillin. That's why I'm so happy, because it's like finding a jewel on the street. It's not something that I sit and learn. I'm learning all the time. But this is like extra bonus. So for me, it's a reason to make a party. You understand? From all this gdolim, we learn how to take advantage on time. Now, the last thing before we finish, and if you have more questions, feel free. I want to warn you, I don't know the policy of your parents in the house. They allow you to look at computers, they allow you to look at things. When I go around, I see from kids that they somehow have connection to Facebook and to very dangerous things. There is no way to be a tzaddik talmid chacham when half of your life is in a holy place and half in a makom tameh. You cannot have one leg in a mikveh and one leg inside the bathroom. It doesn't work. You have to make up your mind. Are you with Hashem or are you against him? It cannot be half enough. Now, you're young. That's why I'm talking to you now. If I have to talk to you in 2-3 years from now, it will be too late. That's it. It's like an addiction. Lo aleinu, once a person starts something and he does it so many hundreds of times, that's it. It's hard, very hard to stop. Much, much harder. Don't start with this. Don't allow anyone to give you ideas to buy all these devices, all these things, because it takes away your mind and your heart away from Hashem. You understand? You have to be very careful. Yes, it's like an addiction. You're going to want to do more and more and more. And the next thing, it's very hard for you to learn and to focus. Because the Torah only stays in a pure mind. If the mind is not pure, if a person doesn't watch his eyes, a person sees things he's not supposed to, all kinds of goyish movies, all kinds of goyish promo, pictures on the street, picture on the bus, who knows? Gotta be very careful. You understand? I tell you a quick story and we'll finish with this. One time I came to Queens Boulevard. My friend used to own a restaurant there. So he told me, you always get the guys and bring them to the yeshiva in Muncie. I have an easy job for you. I said, well, he said, there is an Israeli guy here. He doesn't know what to do with his life. He just came from a trip. He has a big bag on his back. You can 5 minutes, you can talk to him, you can take him to the yeshiva. He looks like a very comfortable person. He won't give you a hard time. So you know what, I'm not that far, I'm coming. I came, I saw a guy, Yemenite, Israeli guy, 22 years old, Oren his name, curly hair, jeans, you know. If he wouldn't tell me he's Israeli, I wouldn't know if he's a Jew, Bechlal. Started to talk to him, and I saw that he's confused, he doesn't know what to do. So I told him, come to Monsi, you learn Torah, you have a place to sleep, we'll give you good food. You know, it's a beautiful place, trees, lake, there's a park on Friday, we go to the park together, there's nice things there. Come, try a week or two. He said, okay, sound good. I didn't have to convince him, Bechlal. No problem, so let me arrange everything. I live right here by my friend. I put my stuff together, wait for me 10 minutes and I come. I took him to yeshiva. I put him in yeshiva. Maybe 3 or 4 weeks later, I walk in the street, I park the car, so I walk towards the yeshiva. So I see he's walking towards me. But he's already 10 steps in front of me and he doesn't say hello. Usually, he ran to me, hi, Rabbi, are you? He walks like this. I see him in front of me. I'm waiting. I'm mamash face to face. Continue to walk. So I say, Oren, where are you going? He said, oh, he took his glasses from his pocket. He put his glasses. Oh, I'm so sorry, I didn't see you. I said, oh, you don't see anything without your glasses? He said, nothing, maybe 1 foot. Don't see anything. I said, so why you don't put your glasses when you walk? He say, I don't want to look at the Natsanua ladies. Now this is Mansi, you're not talking Queens here. Queens, you have a lot of going. Mansi, you don't find it on the street. It's all Haredi people, all very religious people. Maybe once a week some cleaning lady will pass by mistake he will see her. So he takes away his glasses, he doesn't want to see. So then I say to him, after a year or two that he was in yeshiva, maybe we have to find you a shidduch. He said, no. First, I have to learn a lot of Torah. Now I have my mind to learn Torah. I'm still single. When I would like to get married, I'm going to make an aliyah to Eretz Israel. I trust Hashem as soon as I get there to find me my shidduch. Guess what? In the first day he landed in Eretz Israel, they already found him a shidduch. A week later, he was engaged. Why? When you are serious with Hashem, everything you want, He will give you. But if you half enough, it won't work. 100% with Hashem, it works tremendously. Half enough, 10 hours Torah and then 2 hours nonsense, it's not good. Few more questions before we finish, if you have. Yes?
Well, why do we have to put the tefillin on the weekend? Why do we have to put the tefillin on the weekend instead of the strong hand?
The Gemara say al yadecha, it's yad keha. Yad keha means the weak hand. Chazal, the oral Torah, the Torah shebe'al peh, they learn it from the pasuk. Now you have to know when Hashem gave us the written Torah, He gave us the Torah shebe'al peh with it. There's no way to understand one mitzvah from the Torah Shebichtav without going into Torah Shebe'al Peh to see all the comments and the explanation that Hashem gave us in Har Sinai. You understand? It has to be the size of the heart, the tefillin, it has to be on the heart, that's where the Yetzer Hara is. There's a lot of reasons for it. But the Gemara speak about your questions, and I'm sure you're going to get to it one day in the Gemara, and you'll see it over there. No? Yeah? Very good. You have a very good question. Since the pshat said that you have to put on a weekday, so if you write with your left, you have to put it on the right. But I have news for you. After you finish davening, you have to take it away from the right and put it on the left. No, the same tefillin, up the other way around. You turn it around and you put. You understand? Without bracha, because you already made the bracha before.
How about if you play like sports with your left hand and you write with your right hand?
It's only go by writing. Right. You're right. Some people do things in both hands. That's why we have to see what hands you're writing with. If you write with your right hand, then you are righty. If you write with your left, you are lefty. Yeah.
My cousin is not religious, and I want to try to make him more religious and start becoming Shomer Shabbat and putting tefillin. So what do I do to try to do that?
If you give him CDs, he's going to listen? If you give him a DVD, he will watch it?
Yeah, I guess.
Okay, you come to me when we're done to my car. I give you a few free CDs to give him. Okay? And that will help. Yes?
But what if, let's say, you write with your left and you play sports with your right, and you taught yourself how to write with your right hand?
It's only what you're writing with. Doesn't matter if...
You taught yourself how to write with your right hand.
Then you what?
Then you taught yourself how to write with your right hand, and then you don't know...
It's what you were naturally with. What you were, if you used to write with the right, and then you taught yourself to write with the left, you're considered righty. Yes? Why all the questions is about feeling? That's what you learned today in class? Huh? I'm curious. Okay, go ahead. One second. You put it on the thing, you say, Shema Yisrael, Hashem Elokeinu, Hashem Echad, Ve'avta et Hashem Elokecha, first parasha, mamash 10, 20 seconds, and you take it off. Yes.
Why do people celebrate Shabbat, like 13, why not 14, 15, 12?
We learned from the Torah that a person become mature enough, age 13 for a boy, and age 12 for a girl. That's called bar mitzvah, when a person gets to this age. But I have news for you. If Hashem would give the Torah to this generation, he probably would make it age 20. Because the people are not exactly mature like they used to be 3,000 years ago. But we have no permission to change from the Torah. It's the Torah of Hashem. Any more questions? Yeah.
This week's parasha, Vayera.
Yeah.
Abraham went to the three men.
Three malachim that looks like men. Yeah. Yeah.
So, and why did he, if he was in pain, why would he do that? Why would he make himself invite them as guests?
You know, accepting guests is like accepting Hashem. That Gemara says, Gadol achnasat orchim, yoter, even more than accepting the Shechina of Hashem. When a person like Avraham Avinu, the main mitzvah of his life was chesed, Avraham isha chesed, he couldn't live a minute without achnasat orchim. Because remember, he had a tent, it's open for four directions, he pays for all the food. All he wants is the people to recognize this one God and to pray and to say thank you to him. Once you do something every day, it's like someone who learned Torah, he cannot live without it. I have a cousin, even when he's very, very sick, no matter what, he's never going to close the Gemara. No matter, 10 o'clock at night, all day he had high fever, he's at home, maybe he couldn't come to yeshiva, but he cannot stop learning. He eats, he learns. You know, I'll tell you something. You know, Rav Ben Zion, Abba Shaul, you see his picture over there, and when you enter to the yeshiva, next time when you look at him, I'll tell you a story that you admire him even more than before. My cousin asked him, he was his Talmid, Rabbi, which mitzvah is hard for you to keep? Which mitzvah you cannot do? No one is perfect. We're not malachim. So he thought he's going to say, Ve'avta le'reacha kamocha, maybe lo tachmod, there's some hard mitzvot. Guess what he answered? He said, I don't understand how it's possible to be a few minutes in the bathroom without thinking about Torah. I just can't do it. I fail in this mitzvah. You understand? When a person going to a bathroom is not makom tameh, cannot think about what you learn. So that was the hardest thing for him to do. What do you see from here? That he couldn't live a minute without learning. No matter when, as soon as his eyes are open, from the minute until they close, he's always learning. So the same thing Avraham Avinu. If Avraham is so devoted to this mitzvah, and now he's laying in bed and he loses it, he cannot live without it. That's why he wanted to show Hashem that even in hard times like this, I'm not giving up the mitzvah. And Hashem made it the hardest day ever to make Avraham stay at home. But Avraham, not giving up. This is what I said in the first words that I started here today. It's all about how serious and how much you're willing to sacrifice. You give all your heart, bechol levavcha, Hashem help you a lot more than somebody else. Okay, time ran out. Baruch Hashem. Thank you very much for coming.
Sit down for a second.
It was my pleasure speaking to each one of you here today. And Bezrat Hashem, if you have any cousins, any relatives that are not religious, please come to me. I'll give you CDs to give them, okay? Thank you very much. Thank you, Rabbi.